Here in my toenail today, John.
Anyway, Carl, we're live.
We're live. So I'll stop talking about my toenail then. I've got an ingrowing toenail, that's all. So I've cut a V in it to encourage the nail to grow inwards.
That's about the best way you can.
Yeah. It's you're a man of the body and anatomy, so.
Yeah, but I don't massage toes. Unless I can help it.
Right, how are we going to kick off with this story then?
So I think, for anyone that doesn't know, I'll basically introduce who John is, what he's kind of, how we sort of crossed paths, I guess. So, as many people would already know, just from a few of the previous posts we've done, John won the KTM SX250 from us a few weeks ago. Obviously, Callum, you know about this. This is more for educating anyone that's watching or the giveaway live fans on the Facebook page. So,
yeah, for sure.
John won the KTM SX250. He opted for the cash alternative. So mm-hmm. we ended up settling on a cash prize instead of the KTM due to a few reasons. I'm sure we'll go into that later anyway. John, you can touch on that, can't you? But he had an accident a few years ago and decided it's probably best not to take the bike.
Not to ever go near a bike again.
basically, I see too many people come across this couch and fixing them. And then, and the other reason, as Cal rightly adhered to, too fat and too old.
John, I'm 30 and, well, I'm coming up rapidly approaching 30. And I feel too old.
I was going to say, fat and old, so rich coming from you, Cal.
What's that?
Fat and old, rich coming from you.
Yeah. I'm fat and middle aged, so.
Wow.
So imagine that being at 62 then.
Yeah, it's just double. So you feel doubly as worse as what I feel. Is that
no, because I'm a therapist and I know how to treat my body.
Yeah, you can treat, yeah, so pretty, yeah. Probably equal that. I'm sat up. My John, me and you need to meet up soon because my body's pretty destroyed from racing.
But anyway, we'll get onto that later on. But yeah, for anyone joining the feed, the kind of formality of this chat is John obviously won the KTM. We settled on a cash settlement. John very generously donated £1,500 to a charity that's quite close to his heart. Which is another reason for this kind of live stream. We just want to touch on sort of John's experience, John's story with the charity, and just how we can sort of spread further awareness and help out moving forward, and our kind of plans to sort of implement a feature within the business where we kind of help these charities, and especially Shooting Stars Children's Hospice, which John, I'm sure, can touch on as well. But yeah, that's kind of the formality of it, and obviously it's very generous of John to do so and take the cash.
Yeah, it's cool. It's cool. Like sometimes it just takes someone taking part like John to make us aware of a charity like that.
Exactly. Yeah.
I think, you know, I would have never even known who they are.
No.
Before, so it just, you know, it's nice that's happened, and like, obviously we can now, like, going forward, we may be able to help them out some more and build a bit more.
Exactly, yeah, that's the plan, isn't it? And I think it was just, it was kind of a matter of time before, we were always on the lookout, weren't we, for helping a charity. Obviously,
the idea is to do something with the air ambulance
exactly,
as well.
Exactly, yeah, obviously. So we're air ambulance and this Shooting Stars Children's Hospice. So, like you say, we probably wouldn't have ever come across it, but we were kind of waiting for something, weren't we? And that's what it turned out to be. So yeah, we just want to educate people that are members of the page and like the page, and just basically give them a little bit of an insight into what's gone on over the past week or so with chatting with John and helping the charity out. So yeah, I guess over to you, John.
Well, thank you guys, and the reason I actually did join up was because of another one of these live feeds that Cal did with regards to supporting riders. And I thought, you know what, if I can give 20 quid to support a rider and get a ticket, so be it. Never thought for a minute that I'd be getting that phone call on that Sunday night driving home. I really didn't. And so basically I was sitting there and the guys sort of wrapped the show up, and I then had to explain to my wife what it was all about, because she knew nothing of what I've been doing. So bless her, she was very good, and she said, well, where are you going to put it then? And you really think you'll fit enough to ride it?
Yeah,
those were the two sort of questions she asked me. And I'm thinking, where can I put it? I really want to ride that bloody thing. And then I thought, how many people have been across this couch and how many people have I repaired? Yeah. And you know what just literally came into my mind was Jacob, who's my wife's grandson, and who unfortunately passed away. And he passed away from a brain tumour, which is called a choroid plexus carcinoma, and it was a grade 3 cancerous tumour to the brain.
Yeah.
Bless him, after many, many operations, and by Great Ormond Street, he was... We eventually took him down on the 28th of December in 2018 to St Christopher's Children's Hospice down at Guildford. And that's where he spent the next 5 weeks, bless him, until he passed away on the...
It's all right, mate. Dude, it's emotional, isn't it? When you're telling a story like that. I've got a little boy at the minute, John, and when you... Even when you say that, it gives me chills, you know, because I couldn't imagine what you guys have gone through.
Absolutely. And even I've spoke to John numerous times this week, and each time it becomes more shocking, doesn't it?
It's horrible. But
yeah, I'm back with you now, guys. Sorry.
It's all right.
It's all right.
So we took him down there. Well, Gemma and John, that's his mum and dad, took him down there. And we saw the family, all Monica's family, myself, we all went down there with him, not so expecting to get in or anything like that, just treat Jacob, look after him, see what's going on. But they welcomed us with open arms. And then
all the families in your situation as well, it's probably...
Yeah, I mean, that happens. It's bespoke to each different family, though, what they actually do. So they'll look and they'll assess, and then they'll go from there. And poor John and Gemma were just not getting any sleep, the worry, and, you know, when's the inevitable going to happen? And so the hospital then, or St Christopher's, then took over and worked alongside John and Gemma. And I'll give you a couple of things that they actually did. John, Jacob's dad, he had his birthday and was able to spend birthday down there with him. So they made a bit of a fuss, made him a cake and everything.
That's lovely.
And then it was my wife's birthday in the January as well. And they allowed the whole family to go in and have a Chinese meal.
Really?
Yeah, unbelievable. We invited the staff to have some food with us, like, you know, because there was just so much of it and everything else. But it was just that welcoming thing. Nothing was too much of a problem. And yeah, it was amazing what they did. And that's always stuck with me. And one of the things that I was actually able to do with Jacob was they've got a little swimming pool in there. And I was able to just go in with John, Gemma and Harley, that's Jacob's brother, and just have a little swim. And I just held Jacob, and we were just sort of floating around in this pool and everything else. And he gave John and Gemma time to play with Harley, which he loved. And then the next time their cousins came in with us, and everyone was mucking about. But one of the things which I'm going to giggle about now, Jacob wouldn't go in that pool without his pom bears. He loved to eat pom bears. And they had to come in the pool with us.
So they got a bit wet, didn't they?
and then the other thing he would have was, bless him, he would have three dummies, and he'd swap one over and then swap it over again. They had to come in as well.
He had a system.
And it was amazing. You know, he went through all them operations up in Great Ormond Street, not a murmur, smile, happy face he'd come out with. And then we went down there and they were absolutely brilliant, absolutely amazing. And I can't say enough. So that came into my head when I was talking to you, Cal, on that on that night. And I thought, you know what? Having a couple of days before that, heard that they'd actually, because they've got a head office and another hospital at Hampton, and then they've got this one at at Guildford. And they've had to mothball the Hampton one. And that's because of, unfortunately, because of COVID. And, you know, with all the fundraising and everything else that's happened. Now, we thought then it would close, but no, it hasn't. It's been mothballed. We found this out yesterday.
Yeah.
So, you know, I just thought, I've got to try. I've got to do something. I won this. You guys were good enough
to,
you know, offer me the money. So, and I just said it. And Mon just looked at me. And, she just, are you sure? That's what she was saying to me next week. Are you sure? Like, it'll be done.
Yeah.
You know, I've just got my job off saying I'll do a triathlon for them and everything else. And we'll come back to that, Cal.
We will come back to that.
Okay, you're going to do a triathlon?
I've done one before.
You better not be dragging me into this.
I think
me and you in wetsuits. I don't think that's an appealing sight, is it?
Listen, if I can squeeze into one with this. Anyway, we'll come back to that. But and unfortunately, due to some personal reasons, and also my son-in-law literally near enough trying to kill himself on a sidecar outfit at Canada Heights the week before, I pulled a ripcord and bailed out, and I've done nothing since. But however, COVID has made me start to train, and I am gonna do that that triathlon, and that'll hopefully be next year, but that'll be for another thing to do. But for this now, it's just a small thing I can do to help these guys.
Yeah.
And I'll keep doing it. And I'm, be honest, we're just talking with Jake this week. I'm totally blown away with what's gone. I know John and Gemma are. You spoke to Gemma yesterday, Jake.
Yeah, Jake told me.
And I actually think they're on here watching us now, so...
Hopefully.
I did try to get them.
Let's see if you can see her. She's on the stream. I can see her now.
Well, the thing is, what I was thinking as well, like, if we can get something, I don't know, maybe a regular thing to this charity, like, maybe we could get you as to be the informant to everybody, so you could jump on, I don't know, once a month or once every couple of months, John, and let everybody know what's going on, and you can be the connection between us and them.
Shooting Stars are aware of what you guys have been doing. They didn't know about the bit that was offered to me last night. They don't know, so I'll let you guys explain that and what you're going to try and do.
Yeah.
But I'd gladly come on and be an informant. And Cal, you mentioned something a minute ago, you wanted to do something for the air ambulance.
Yeah.
But if you can 100%. Do that, then because of what they did for my son-in-law at Canada Heights that day.
Yeah.
That's really close, mate, and I can't, guys.
Exactly. I think the air ambulance in our sport is, if it wasn't for them, there'd be people dying every weekend at tracks, if it wasn't for the air ambulance.
Yeah.
Simple as that. It is simple as that. So, obviously, we need to make sure that me and Jake and we've got another partner, we're going to all put our heads together and work out sort of a viable solution to be able to help, you know, a handful of charities.
That's exactly what we want to do moving forward. We kind of set up to be the go-to kind of motocross competitions company that is just specialised in motocross. That is our niche. We're not in any way looking to branch out into sort of
doing Lamborghinis and things.
Technology or Lamborghinis. We want to build a community that is focused around motocross. Help the motocross community in terms of young riders coming through, sponsorships, air ambulance. It's a good idea of Callum's, to be fair. You put two and two together. We supply people with motocross bikes. That is what we do. People win motocross bikes from us. But yeah, motocross bikes can be dangerous. So as part of us being having a sort of what's the word? Is it obligation as a business?
Yeah, I suppose so. That's what I was thinking of as well.
Yeah.
We're sort of obliged to
exactly. So
people who are swinging their leg over these things as well.
Yeah. So a percentage moving forward of we're yet to agree with the guys over there until we meet with them, but we're looking to sort of put a percentage of ticket sales per motocross bike we draw. We'll always go to the charity. So say for example, if it was 1% of tickets and there's 500 tickets, then 5 tickets essentially belong to the charity. They could be the same numbers every time, pre-agreed, so that everybody knows that number 5,
those 10, numbers 15, are allocated 20, to both of these charities.
They're charity numbers. If they ever came out, it's a charity that's won that. And similar situation to yourself, John, we would then offer a cash settlement to the charity, and they would, instead of getting a 2016 Honda CRF, they would get £3,500 cash sum, which obviously is quite a big deal. That's just one of the initial ideas that we've had and something we'd like to implement with the Shooting Stars Hospice as well.
100%. I'm completely on board with that. I can see how much of that's touched John and obviously so many other people. I couldn't imagine ever being in that situation, John. I just couldn't. It's heartbreaking.
It is unimaginable. You can't ever begin to imagine what it's
as
like
much as somebody. As much as my little lad's annoyed me today with his consistent moaning. I'd rather hear his consistent moaning. You know, like it's horror. It's horrifying, isn't it?
It is. Really. Yeah. But yeah, whatever we can do, we're going to try and do it. We have certain. We have certain goals and certain aspirations that we want to meet, and as part of that, we know we need to sort of step up and supply to these things. So we just want to help out where we can do, really.
On behalf of Shooting Stars, I mean, I'm sure that they will be writing to you guys and getting in touch. Thank you. It's really, really appreciated. And as I said earlier on, it's actually blown me away what you guys are trying to achieve and trying to do. Just to give you an idea of some of the things that they've done, they've sent me over a little list. So if you're all right, I'm going to just read this out.
Yeah, 100%.
So Shooting Star Hospice cares for baby and children with young people and life-limiting conditions and their families. Whether their lives are measured in days, weeks, months or years, we are here to make every moment count. And trust me, from first hand, that they do that. No, they actually really do it.
Yeah.
We help families by supporting them with diagnosis to end of life, throughout bereavement, and with a range of nursing and practical and emotional and medical care. They're still in touch with Gemma and John now, even though it's, you know, a period of time afterwards. They still talk to them and they're still in touch with them. So I know that firsthand. Not only them, but grandparents as well and the other kids. They all make sure they're okay. Shooting Star Hospice is a lifeline for families we support. The pandemic has had an undeniable impact on how we can deliver our vital services. We've had to adapt and find new different ways to ensure we can continue to provide families with care that's responsive to their needs. And in order to do that, we rely on our supporters generally for the future. Thank you, guys. And emergency or urgent respite, including symptom stays and step-down care. Do you know, we met some wonderful people while we were there. And Monica, my wife, met this lady, and she had 5 kids. She was on her own with them and everything else. And they all had one or two problems. It wasn't end of life, but they had their problems, and she was there for respite. And her words were, without this place, I don't know where I would be. And so for that, you know, for that as well, you know.
Yeah, it's massive, isn't it?
It is, it is. We are currently delivering all our clinical services from our Guildford Hospice, St. Christopher's. Our Hampton Hospice, Shooting Star House, will remain closed from a care perspective for now, but we're looking at how we can use it flexibly. For instance, in July, we had a day of bereaved families at Shooting Star House. We have launched a virtual hospice, including virtual groups, a closed Facebook page, and an online resource hub to continue to reach many families as possible who are self-isolating at home. Over the 6 months following the UK going into lockdown from mid-March to August, we provided 5,036 emotional, practical, social support contacts via Zoom and phone, 437 hours of counselling support via Zoom and phone, 28 youth group chill and chat sessions via Zoom. So, Zoom does work.
Well, we had a bit of a problem. Had a bit of a problem earlier, John.
There are lots of ways to support your local children's hospice charity, from donations, taking part in your own virtual fundraising challenge, and much more. I'm sure you guys, if you haven't, I'll get them across to you, can put up the places where you can go.
Yeah.
I know one of the things that I'm pretty sure they did, Tony Hadley is part of the Shooting Stars group, and he does he's done an online virtual performance, but you had to pay to watch it, and that money went into it. So
John, this charity, and hospices, what I'm taking from it, it's completely sort of self-funded. There's no NHS funding.
They did explain to us, and please, they'll have to quote me.
Yeah, for sure. If it's not 100%.
But it was, they got 10% funding from the NHS.
Right, okay.
The rest is, and those
they
figures
have to generate that themselves.
The figures that they explained to us, and I think this is for like all three, I think it was around about 9 million a year.
Yeah, it's not a lot really in the grand scheme of things, is it?
It's not a lot of money at all, especially for the sort of care that they're having to provide. I mean, that is real intense stuff, isn't it? You know, especially end of life care is, it's horrific to think about, but it is intense stuff. And I suppose at the moment, John, a lot of these families, and especially kids with conditions, they are having to self-isolate, aren't they, as well?
Yeah, they are. Yes, as far as I know, they are, yes. When we were there, the nurses and doctors would all, you're okay, just as you're walking out, you're right, everything okay.
Yeah.
It didn't matter if you looked happy, you looked sad.
They care because they've chosen to work there at the end of the day, haven't they?
Yeah, so they're looking to make a difference, aren't they?
I think they'd have a list. Although it's hard for them, you know, it's as hard for them as it is for the parents, and because they get close to them and everything else.
Yeah.
But they're amazing people. They are like, I think they're gods. They're angels.
Yeah.
They really are. Just amazing people.
Well, it's a selfless act, isn't it, working in that sort of environment? Because it's definitely not for the money.
Yeah.
Even doctors, you know, I always think, you know, when people are moaning about and they're in hospital and stuff and they've got, it's like doctors aren't paid millions of pounds a year to save your life. They're on a pittance compared to what they should be on. They do it because they absolutely love doing what they do at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the way I looked at just giving that little bit of money that I have is like this. If I can keep two of those nurses or doctors in work for 2 months, that's 2 months longer than someone else can have. And that's how I've looked at that. And I'll keep doing it. I'll keep doing my best that I can. I know the family want to do other bits and pieces as well. But, you know, I've done nothing, really. I've just done nothing.
Well, Well,
it's
honestly, John, it's taken a lot of courage to step on here and have this chat with us. And it's the least we can do on our side. I mean, we have a platform that has people on it, and we can put this message across. But I mean, you're the one, Jake,
how many people have been on this live feed?
None, exactly. And it's a massive thing to step up and actually do it. It's brilliant. And you can tell by the preparation and whatnot, that it's all been worth it.
And everybody who's watching this now as well is now aware of your story and what you've gone through and the charity. So to say you haven't done anything, John, you know, I think you have.
You definitely are doing something.
You're spreading awareness.
Yeah, you need to give yourself some credit. And you've done brilliantly. And I'm sure Gemma and John will be over the moon.
When Jacob was first diagnosed, I went up to Preston Docks and I was trying to raise awareness and a bit of money and everything that was going on. We were trying to raise money.
This is the motocross track, Preston Docks.
Yeah, at the motocross track.
Was it what was it? Was it British Championship or
MX Nationals?
MX Nationals, yeah.
Okay. And Jeff was on the mic.
Yeah.
And poor old Jeff, I went over to him, never met him before. And like I've just done on here, I was a mess, a total mess.
Yeah.
And there was a few people, let's just say world-class riders and their parents came up and literally just put money in the hat. Well, that money's gone to them, so that's all there.
Well, I will let you know, when we at the MX Nationals on the weekend, we actually did that on a live feed as well, so people could watch the racing on a live feed. And I think that went out to around about 1,000 people across the world, and I did have a good old chat to Jeff about what you've done and everything as well on that live broadcast. So mate, we were speaking about you, and I can give you the link to the thing and the time, and you can go back and watch what was said. but we gave you a lot of praise, and
thank you, Jeff, for that.
No, it's absolutely fine, and we all miss you at MX Nationals as well.
Well, as I've said to you, Caroline, I've said to Neil and Paul. Who run it? Unfortunately,
it's the insurance.
I just can't get there for the insurance. I just not. And so I've got a deal to it. I understand all the reasons.
Yeah.
But I'm still trading. I'm back working in here.
We'll see you next year, I'm sure.
Yeah, hopefully before, because you're going to need it for what we're about to put you through.
Let's get on to that. I want to hear a bit more about
which bit do you know what the three things are in a triathlon encounter?
Well, I believe it's cycling, running and swimming. Okay.
Which of the things would you like to do?
I think I'd be the most competitive at the cycling.
Oh, he picked the easy option, John. He's picked the easy option. I told you, didn't I?
Option.
I told
it's
you.
I cycle every day.
Yeah, so I think exactly. I told you to pick the easy option.
I think John looks like a swimmer.
Right. So I'll take the swim, and there's a very good reason I'm going to take the swim. Okay. The try that I'd really like to do is the Reading Triathlon. It's only a sprint distance. I'll let you find out what the distances are because I know. But Cal, if you want to go on the bike, buddy, you go on it. And I'll tell you the reason why, because there's a real big long downhill bit in it, and all you got to do is tuck that old tubby belly.
Well, I've got the carbon roadie in the garage.
But how many times has it been out?
Once.
It's covered in dust. It's like a 4 grand bike hanging up, covered in dust. So I'll have to blow it off and I'll have to get some training in, John.
Yeah. Well, Mr.
If we're going to do anything, we're going to be competitive at it. We're not just taking part. We're going to go. Right.
That's a good statement. If we're doing it, we do it properly.
Let me just say this. In a lake, I had two panic attacks. I nearly drowned on the first one, and then the second one, I thought, what the hell am I doing in here for?
John, can we not have any panic attacks in the lake?
Right. There ain't going to be no panic attacks, because when I was swimming with Jacob, that gave me enough strength to go, and he'll be sat on my shoulder saying, come on, John, come on, John. Otherwise, you're going to beat all these pom bears.
You can have a packet of pom bears strapped to your wetsuit.
You have to dress up as a pom bear.
So, if we're going to do it, I'll enter us and I'll pay the entry and I'll give you an idea of when the date is.
And let's get fundraising.
Easy, yeah. I'm up for this anyway. I'll smash this.
You will?
Walk in the park.
So we're going to actually enter the relay. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, I think it's combined age group. I'll have to check that out. But that puts us up a little bit, so it's a little bit easier for us.
That's better. That's fine. That's fine for me.
But when I last did that one, I did struggle, and I ain't going to be struggling this time. And I'm going to be actually pushing you guys bloody hard.
And we're going to vlog the hell out of it. We're all going to be on camera all day. So we don't want any panic attacks on the GoPro.
None of that.
In the water.
I'll tell you now, I am not coming out of that lake the way I did the last time.
It'll be a walk in the park anyway, don't worry. We've got enough time to prepare.
Yeah. So Cal, you've got to make sure with Neil and Paul that it don't clash that
weekend. That's fine. We'll figure something. Mate, if it does, I'll be there anyway. Someone else can fill in for me. I'm replaceable, so don't worry about it.
That's a poor attitude. I feel like you're gonna drop out already.
No, I said I'm replaceable for the MX Nationals.
Oh, right.
Jeff will just have to go at it alone.
Solo.
Yeah, let's go.
And that I saw the weekend, Cal, that you were doing that lovely bit of training there with a Corona in your hand and spraying champagne everywhere.
I was spraying champagne on everybody, man. Because it was the final round, there was people, oh God, it was so stressful. People were winning the championship. So I would be sat there commentating. And then all of a sudden, I'd have Becky run upstairs going, this kid's going to win the championship. And like throwing a bottle of champagne at me. I was like, Then I'd be running down to the end of the track while they're all coming. Oh God, mate. And then, a few times the bottle like prematurely popped as well, which is quite entertaining. It was just everywhere.
It's a good job they were wearing goggles, mate. You didn't get that cork in the eye.
I wanted to get it in the
health
eye.
And safety job, hazard.
I wouldn't mind. I was spraying champagne over like 12-year-old kids. Oh God, never mind.
I can't thank you enough for what you've done.
No problem at all.
I've loved coming on here and talking with you guys, and I will with. And come back sort of once a month and give you some updates of what's going on.
Yeah.
And perhaps we ought to give people progress of training as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that might be a good We want some videos of you in a wetsuit in a lake.
You'd have to fill us in on all the details, John, in terms of dates and whatnot, and we can get it out on socials as well, and we can do our best to kind of make sort of a push for a fundraising effort. So it gives us enough time to sort of prepare and whatnot. So thanks for coming on and obviously sharing everything with us and talking us through where the money's gone and what it's gone to do. It's relieving to hear that somebody's won and really put it to good use. So I know that Callum thinks the same.
Well, I appreciate that, guys. I really do. And to anyone that's listening out there, and I know there's 9 of you on here at the moment, just do it because you can win a bike. And I don't say you have to, give them the money like I did, because I tell you now, if it had been that CR250 Honda, the two-stroke you had, the older one, a few weeks before, we wouldn't be talking.
That would be in your office. That would be in your office, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that would be in here.
Oh, man. Well, we really appreciate it, mate. We really appreciate, obviously, everything you've done, and then educating us on the awareness as well. And I'm really going to look into this charity, and me and Jake and our other partner, we will definitely be having a meeting about this and seeing what we can do going forward.
Yeah, perfect.
Thanks a lot, guys.
I think that's a good way to end it. Anyway, thank you for coming on, John. And then we'll obviously update people as we go on as to the progress on the triathlon and the fundraising efforts. but yeah, big thank you.
I can't wait.
It's taken a lot to obviously come on and do it.
Jake, I've got a question.
Go on, mate.
Are them croissants real in the background there? Are they plastic?
Yeah, do you want one?
Yeah.
I grab you one now.
Just grab one. Right, should we leave it there, guys?
Nice one.
Okay.
Catch you in a bit, guys.
Thank
See you later.
So much.
Thanks very much.
Appreciate it.